Good afternoon. I'll be speaking about retinoblastoma and try to keep it shorter. This is the world retinoblastoma map. If you look at the hot spots, India and China account for a majority of cases. That's because of a higher live birth rate that are inherent to these countries. In India, we have about 1,500 cases of retinoblastoma every year, whereas in the world, there are about 4,500 to 5,000. That means that one third of cases of RB occur in India. Clinical manifestations are very straightforward. The most common symptom is leukocoria. Most common sign is also leukocoria. Parents come with a child manifesting with white reflex, and that's what you see when you look at the patient clinically as well. The second most common symptom as well as a sign is squint in about 23% of patients. It can be esotropia or exotropia depending on the location of the tumor and the age of onset. The third in little older children would be reduced vision, and if it's bilateral retinoblastoma, obviously reduced vision will manifest in poor visual responses of the child, which the mother may notice. Reduced vision is mainly because of a macular location of the tumor or subretinal fluid. These are rare manifestations, accounting for about 4 to 5% of cases each. Redness in the eye when there is inflammation, or proptosis when there is either severe sterile orbital inflammation or orbital retinoblastoma. And that's the clinical spectrum of retinoblastoma. It can start off with a small macular tumor to advanced fungating retinoblastoma. Now, these are some of the mascarats of retinoblastoma. This is a child where somebody diagnosed it as preseptal cellulitis. Of course, there is inflammation, but that's because of a necrotic tumor. Then there could be a white eye hypopyon. The key word here is white eye. That means that there is no circumciliary congestion or conjunctival congestion. Yet the child has what looks like uveitis, that is anterior segment infiltration of retinoblastoma. So white eye hypopyon in a child should be viewed with suspicion. The third would be congenital glaucoma. It can simulate congenital glaucoma, especially if the cornea is very hazy. You may miss the lurking yellowish or white reflex, and it may even present with Hab's stri. So it can have features very similar to congenital glaucoma. And thysis bulbi. Thysis bulbi, because of a tumor necrosis and the eye gets into ciliary body shutdown and thysis over a period of time. Hyphema is one more manifestation. This child even had a trauma. She has a lid laceration there and full chamber hyphema, which the glaucoma surgeon drained without doing a good ultrasound B scan. And 6 months later, child manifested with extraocular retinoblastoma, regional lymph node metastasis, and intracranial extension. So hyphema should never be drained in a child if the trauma is very minor and is unlikely to cause such a severe hyphema, unless we investigate these children at least by a B scan. The last would be a vitreous hemorrhage. Vitreous hemorrhage with blood vessels dilated like this should never be confused for traumatic vitreous hemorrhage, which the surgeon did here. He did a vitrectomy and then a buccal because of a reg RD, and then you can see the whitish patches on top of the indentation, and now posterior to the buccal as well there is whitish extension. So this is a peripheral retinoblastoma advancing centrally in an older child. Generally retinoblastoma presents at the macula when the child is born, central location, but if it's an older child, it presents in the periphery and moves posteriorly. So that's a varied manifestation of RB. And diffuse infiltrative retinoblastoma may not have a mass and calcification. It may simply manifest with generalized thickening of the retina. That's a normal thickness of the retina, and in the involved area it may be twice or thrice thickened. That's how it presents. So you can easily miss it on B scan because these children will never have calcification, or it may be missed that way. These are the mascarats. Now there are four major tumor types. Endophytic, which is most common, seen about 70% of children. Exophytic, little less common, about 20%. Diffuse infiltrative, in very rare situations, especially in older children, and mixed configuration where they have a bit of this and bit of that. Straightforward way of diagnosing retinoblastoma is by indirect ophthalmoscopy. That is the most common way of diagnosing RB. If you have a suspicion, you can do an ultrasound B scan to see if there is any intraocular calcification. Imaging, mainly MRI we prefer because of radiation exposure, and that is to rule out extraocular extension, major choroidal invasion, or optic nerve extension. That can be done, and even pineoblastoma in a heritable situation. Those are the indications for MRI. Most common simulating conditions. Now we should know what are the conditions which simulate retinoblastoma. These are the five top ones. The order may be different depending on the place where you work or your referral pattern, but these are the five common conditions. Coats disease is very, very different from retinoblastoma in terms of its manifestation. It presents with what is called xanthochoria. Yellowish, golden yellowish reflex is what you see in Coats disease. Whereas in retinoblastoma, you find a stark white. So there's a huge difference in the way you look at the reflex. And when you look at these patients carefully with indirect ophthalmoscopy, you find dilated blood vessels and peripheral retinal telangiectasia. So extensive peripheral retinal telangiectasia is a feature of Coats disease. And when you do ultrasound, you don't find a mass in Coats disease. You may find specks of calcification, that's all right, but there is no mass in Coats disease, whereas in retinoblastoma, you will find an obvious mass. In persistent hyperplastic primary vitreous, you find white reflex, but the eye will be relatively microphthalmic, say horizontal corneal diameter of even 9.5 as opposed to 10.5-11 in the other eye is relative microphthalmos, and that's what is present in PHPV and prominent ciliary processes, and there's a posterior polar cataract with a vascular tuft leading onto the optic disc, and that's what exactly what you see in the B scan, posterior polar membrane and the vascular tuft leading onto the optic disc, whereas in RB you find a mass. So there's a clear difference between PHPV and retinoblastoma. Toxocara presents with traction wherever it is. It may be in the periphery, like this is a peripheral toxocara and that's a falciform fold, whereas in retinoblastoma you find none of that. And that's a macular toxoplasmosis or a posterior polar toxoplasmosis, toxocariasis. Again, that presents with drag disc appearance because of desmoplasia, whereas retinoblastoma simply sits silent without any desmoplasia at all. Retinal astrocytic hematoma can be of two types, non-calcified, sits on the retina like a button obscuring the blood vessels, whereas a calcified variant can sometimes simulate retinoblastoma. So you must keep that in mind and look for systemic manifestations of astrocytic hematoma such as neurofibromatosis and tuberous sclerosis, and if the child has that, your suspicion for astrocytic hematoma is much higher. Medulloepithelioma presents as a peripheral tumor with loss of zonules. It's an embryonic tumor, so zonules don't develop in that area, leading to what is called a lens coloboma or a zonular coloboma, but it's a ciliary body tumor, not a retinal tumor, and that's how you differentiate medulloepithelioma from retinoblastoma. Coming on to classification. Now, classification has to be very logical and it should be simple to recall. Reese Ellsworth, I can't remember myself, I have to look at the chart and then recollect. It's a very difficult classification. It doesn't follow the clinical evolution of retinoblastoma or the treatment. After all, why do you want classification? Classification is important to prognosticate. Basically, you look at a child and tell parents that, okay, your child has group D retinoblastoma, so chance of eye salvage is 80%. That's what you want to tell. It's a very simple way of prognosticating. So classification will have two systems. One is staging. Staging where survival is the outcome. You'll say that your child has no risk for life at all. That means that you have staged it as stage 0. But if your stage is already 4B, then you say that your child has very remote chance of survival, although we'll try our best. So that's what is staging. Whereas grouping, the organ is the thing in question. So eye salvage is for grouping. This is international staging of retinoblastoma. Stage 0, where no enucleation has been performed and the child has been managed conservatively. Stage 1, where enucleation has been performed and the tumor is completely resected, which means that the pathologist has to tell you that the tumor is completely resected. So pathologist's role is very important. If there is residual retinoblastoma at the optic nerve cut end or full thickness sclera is involved, that means tumor is not resected completely and there is microscopic residual tumor which immediately changes the stage. Stage 3 is regional extension to orbit or regional lymph nodes, and stage 4 is metastatic retinoblastoma. This is actually a watershed zone. Stage 3, up to stage 3, there is 95% survival. Beyond stage 3, there is less than 2% survival. So you should never let a child go to stage 4 from stage 3. So this is international grouping of intraocular retinoblastoma. This is a kindergarten grouping, I would call, because it's very, very simple and easy to remember. A, for small tumors which are less than 3 millimeter. B is for bigger tumors more than 3 millimeter, which are in the macular location or with subretinal fluid. So that's group B. C is for confined subretinal seeds, as in exophytic retinoblastoma, confined vitreous seeds, as in endophytic retinoblastoma. Remember D as diffuse subretinal seeds in exophytic, diffuse vitreous seeds in endophytic. E are potentially enucleabilized with the 75% of the ocular volume filled with the tumor, neovascular glaucoma, blood in the anterior chamber of vitreous. What's really new is AJCC classification. In fact, this was asked in DNB exam classification of retinoblastoma and AJCC is expected. It's difficult to remember, but at least the gross part of it you should reproduce. And what is most important to point out here is that this is the only malignancy where H category has been added. So it is TNM. AJCC is TNM, but in retinoblastoma it is TNMH, H for hereditary. So if a child has hereditary retinoblastoma, that goes as TNM H1 or H0 or H1. Coming to management, goals are very clear. Any cancer, salvage of life is the primary goal, followed by salvage of the organ and salvage of visual function. These are the treatment options. There are many treatment options. But when you have a very small tumor where there is no risk to life, then you rely on focal therapy. So when you want to save eye and vision, you have to be less damaging. You cannot blast a foveal tumor with laser and expect the child to have vision, isn't it? So you have to be very, very conservative when you want to save vision. And there are options to save vision. One is cryotherapy for peripheral tumor. We prefer it for nasally located peripheral tumor, not temporally, because even if it's anterior to equator, it may still cause dragging of the macula, etc., because cryo is very heavy here. It is triple freeze-thaw cryotherapy, not just the tumor, but also including the vitreous on top of it. So this is frozen the tumor, and there's a cuff of vitreous that also has to be frozen. That's how severe cryo is. So when you do that, this is the tumor that we began with, and look at the scar, much larger than the tumor. So you never want to do it in the equatorial tumor, especially on the temporal side, but nasal periphery cryo is okay. Multiple sessions of cryotherapy can lead to retinal breaks, so it should be avoided. Heavy cryo can lead to ablatio fugax or exudative retinal detachment. That also has to be avoided. Keeping that in mind, cryo is a good option. Second is photocoagulation. Now, photocoagulation, the principle is to cut off the blood supply to the tumor. How do you do that? You cannot photocoagulate on top, so you do it around the tumor. So you do two rows of large diameter laser burns around the tumor. This is how it will look. This is the tumor that we began with, and look at the scar. If you calculate the area, that would be about 9 to 10 times the tumor that you began with. And look at the blood vessel, it's blocked. So you cause small vessel, blood vessel block. And if you do a juxtapapillary tumor photocoagulation, then the child's visual field will be knocked off. You'll find an inferior arcuate scotoma if you were to photocoagulate a superior juxtapapillary tumor. So photocoagulation is definitely not a good option. It causes a lot of complications. We have stopped doing photocoagulation and moved on to thermotherapy. Thermotherapy also uses laser, but then it is a semiconductor diode laser, which is supposed to heat up the tumor to about 45 to 60 degrees centigrade, good enough to produce tumor cell apoptosis, thereby producing a small gentle scar. So TTT is done right on top of the tumor, whereas photocoagulation is done around the tumor. So scar that is produced by TTT is just the size of the tumor itself, never larger than the tumor that you began with. And the blood vessels you see are quite patent. So you produce minimal damage to the collateral damage to the retina by doing transpupillary thermotherapy. And you deliver it using indirect ophthalmoscope. So reach is immense. You can reach right up to the aura. So most of the indications for cryotherapy have now been converted to doing transpupillary thermotherapy. It's 1,300 micron spot size. So you don't take much time doing it. If you were to have 250 micron or 500 micron, then you take long time doing photocoagulation or TTT. Here the spot size is very large. That's a magnified view of the same. When you have a larger tumor, then you go to local therapy. Local therapy can be with plaque brachytherapy. For tumors which are about 16 millimeter in diameter and 8 millimeter in thickness, plaque is good. Plaque is done even for juxtapapillary tumors, works very well, but ultimately it produces some complications like you see blood vessel block and RP atrophy. So child may not have good vision despite plaque brachytherapy, tumor having reduced. EBRT is currently not performed as primary treatment because it has a very high rate of second malignant neoplasm, especially in heritable cases. So just by doing external beam radiation in retinoblastoma, you are increasing mortality by 29%. So this is something which is very important to remember. You may save the child's eye initially, but 5, 10, 15 years later, the child will succumb to second malignant neoplasm. Paradigm change came in the form of chemotherapy. This was the 1996 issue of Archives of Ophthalmology, November issue, which had four articles just on this particular new modality of treatment, chemoreduction. It's 23 years since chemoreduction was described, and it was only described as intravenous standard dose chemoreduction at that point in time. Now it has evolved to high dose chemoreduction, neoadjuvant and adjuvant chemotherapy, intra-arterial, periocular and intraocular. So we started off with intravenous standard dose. Now we have a whole variety of chemotherapy that are possible. Intravenous chemotherapy uses carboplatin, etoposide and vincristine. The beauty of chemotherapy is that if you begin with a large tumor like this, look at the scar. Scar is much smaller than the tumor that you began with because it goes back in time. It shrinks the tumor, whereas TTT produces the same size scar. Chemotherapy is even better because it produces a much smaller scar than you began with. So chemotherapy is extremely good in salvaging vision. And the second principle of chemotherapy is that the tumor moves away from the macular fovea and regresses towards its source of blood supply. For example, this was a supratemporal blood vessel that was supplying the tumor, and the tumor holds on to its source of blood supply because it's a hungry tumor, needs blood supply. It will shrink towards it, away from the macular fovea in a centrally located tumor, thus to your advantage because the child will have maximum visual benefit. The next advantage of chemotherapy is that SRF goes away very rapidly. Retinal detachment settling down is a good sign again because that produces better visual outcome. Now, with standard dose chemotherapy that we began with in 1996, we had good success in early retinoblastoma, but for advanced cases, we had bad outcome. And these are the ones which we need to bother about in India, because in India, 75% of patients have advanced retinoblastoma at presentation. There we had to do something different, and that was in the form of intraarterial chemotherapy or high dose chemotherapy. Now, intraarterial chemotherapy is done with the help of an interventional neuroradiologist who gets us access to the ophthalmic artery. Then it's our job to inject a group of one drug or three drugs. We use three drugs because we want a very good effect of intraarterial chemotherapy without many sessions because it's an expensive form of treatment. We use topotecan, melphalan and carboplatin. This is total bullous retinal detachment. Following one session of intraarterial chemotherapy, all that is settled and the tumor is on its way to regression. Similar situation, it works beautifully well. In fact, it works best for group D retinoblastoma. A, B, C, anything is okay, but D is where it really works well. All these group D retinoblastomas are fine. Now, the next bit is about retinoblastoma seeds. Earlier, we knew only of vitreous seeds. That's what you all know, right? Now, there are many forms of seeds that have been described. This is all in the last 3 or 4 years. Classic vitreous seeds, we all knew. Now we have intracameral seeds, which have been further classified as depository, those that just come through the zonules and settle in the anterior chamber, infiltrative, which come as contiguous extension from the ciliary body tumor, and on OCT, we have pre-hyaloid, subhyaloid, epiretinal, intraretinal, and subretinal seeds. And each of these can be currently treated. How do these form? These form by two mechanisms. One is break in the internal limiting membrane and growth of the vitreous seeds, which is the most common mechanism. The second is sprouting of the vitreous seeds. If it is broken, it just forms very small vitreous seeds. But if it's a sprout like this, so generally sprout begins like this and then it becomes like that, and this smaller end breaks off and this large vitreous seed gets into the vitreous cavity. So this is a large vitreous seeds that you have to deal with. Once it forms, it follows two mechanisms of proliferation. One is adherence independent growth. That means that vitreous nutrition is enough for the seeds to proliferate. So it's simply in the vitreous cavity. The second one is adherence dependent growth. That means that it needs a retinal substrate and nutrition from the retina to grow. Those form typical epiretinal seeds. Anyway, once they form, I'll skip this. They can be in three different morphologies, dust, cloud and sphere, or a mixed morphology. And the way to treat them, earlier we used to give periocular carboplatin, then we shifted to periocular topotecan with about 70% success. But that's not still good. 70% is something that you would just pass, isn't it? You want distinction. So you want something better, and that came in the form of intraocular chemotherapy. Intraocular chemotherapy with melphalan was what was described by the Japanese group and popularized by Munier. It is done by a safety enhanced technique. But that causes a lot of retinal toxicity in Asian Indian eyes and also uveitis and cataract. So we use topotecan. Melphalan is very good, you see that. But this is the kind of retinal toxicity it can produce in pigmented eyes. So we have moved away from topotecan to melphalan to topotecan. Topotecan is a much gentle drug. It doesn't cause the toxicity and the vitreous seeds go away very soon. So it needs about, you need about 2 to 3 injections of topotecan 3 weekly, whereas melphalan is weekly injection, making it logistically difficult as well. This is again a patient with topotecan. So topotecan, initially when we reported, we found 100% success. Now we don't have such high success because we are now giving it to very advanced cases as well. So currently we have about 90% success, which is still good. And a combination therapy of topotecan and melphalan works well in refractory vitreous seeds. When 6 injections of topotecan fail, we add on a little bit of melphalan, not bad enough to cause retinal toxicity, but good enough to cause vitreous seed regression. Anyway, now regression pattern of vitreous seeds has also come about. We know regression patterns of intraocular tumor. Now this is a new thing, regression pattern of vitreous seeds. For anterior segment seeds, we give intracameral injection. So this patient has been treated who had anterior segment seeds, you see that, with intracameral injection of topotecan. 5 microgram is all that it takes for the seeds to go away. Earlier, we were actually straight away enucleating these patients because there was no form of treatment that was available. With all this added together, our success is much better. From 25%, we have jumped to 80% in group 5B. Enucleation, when it is done, you have to provide a primary implant and a custom-made ocular prosthesis so that parents are happy, at least with the cosmesis, if the child has lost the eye. Following enucleation, we have to look for histopathological risk factors, which can be iris or ciliary body infiltration, major choroidal infiltration, which is choroidal invasion more than 3 mm thick and 3 mm in diameter, and optic nerve invasion beyond the lamina cribrosa, which is present in about 55% of Indian eyes that undergo enucleation. In such patients, we have to give adjuvant chemotherapy with very good success. This is to show the benefit of adjuvant chemotherapy. If you are not to give it, 24% mortality. If you are to give it, 4% mortality. So just by this simple measure, we are saving about 20% more children. So every bit of advance in treatment adds to life salvage. Currently, we have about 95 to 99% life salvage in retinoblastoma. In orbital retinoblastoma, we have a new classification: primary, when the child presents with it; secondary, following enucleation there is recurrence; and accidental is when somebody does an intraocular surgery and the tumor becomes extraocular; overt is when you find it following enucleation; microscopic, when the pathologist tells you that there is resected margin positive. Now we had 70% mortality with orbital RB. Now with multimodal treatment, actually this is one example where there is orbital RB following neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Eye has gone into comfortable thysis when we would enucleate, give stereotactic radiation, and then adjuvant chemotherapy. So it's a year-long treatment resulting in cure. Optic nerve extension gone with, again, neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Cavernous sinus extension again gone with neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And children don't have to undergo orbital excentration anymore. They just undergo an extended enucleation, and cosmesis can be maintained even in this situation. So overall survival is now jumped to about 95%. This is at least in our series, and every other group is using this protocol-based treatment to do much better. So in conclusion, I would say that management of RB is complex, but it needs to be customized to the given situation of the child. And they're very cost-effective protocols. All that we use are very safe and cost-effective. These are not expensive at all, much cheaper than an ordinary cataract surgery, and this would result in much better life salvage. Thank you so much.